Alright, so today I am going to discuss a very important topic with you people, and that is called topicity. And that I am discussing about homotopic, enantiotopic and diastereotopic protons. Now, the reason why I chose this topic is because, first of all, direct questions come from this topic from organic chemistry, okay? And it can be either of the form. They can directly ask you, they will give you two protons and they will ask you whether it's enantiotopic, diastereotopic or homotopic, right? Or what can they do is they can give you NMR and they can ask you number of signals that are obtained for a particular compound, and that particular compound could have enantiotopic protons or diastereotopic protons or homotopic protons, okay? So then how should you proceed? And this particular topic is important and relevant to all exams, be it JAM or GATE or NET, okay? So let's begin. First of all, let's see how do we find out whether a compound has homotopic protons, diastereotopic protons and enantiotopic protons. So there is a very simple method to find that out, okay? So let's say we have ethane, okay? So we have a CH3 and a CH3, okay? So we have something like this. Let's say this bond is above the plane and this hydrogen is below the plane, okay? I'll just draw it a little bigger, it might be difficult for you to see. So we have ethane molecule, CH3, C, hydrogen, one above the plane, okay, one below the plane. Now what you do is you just replace one of the hydrogens by any group. Say, let's say we'll say that could be X. Or if you want, for simplicity, you can take it to be chlorine, okay? So whatever, I'll take it to be X. So if you, what you do is, for example, you need to find out whether these two protons are homotopic or enantiotopic or diastereotopic. So what you do is, replace both the hydrogen, at one at a time, replace one hydrogen by X, then replace one hydrogen by X. So you get two kind of molecules, okay? So one will be like this. So if you replace this hydrogen by X, you will get this molecule, okay? And if you replace this particular hydrogen by X, you will get these two molecules. One is this, okay? And the other one is this. Now if you see, can you see any difference in the molecule? No, these two molecules are both the same molecules, okay? So there's no difference among the molecules. So if you replace one of both the, if you want to see that whether these two hydrogens are enantiotopic, diastereotopic or homotopic, you replace them by any group. Say I have taken here to be X group, you can take it to be Y, you can take it to be chlorine, you can take it to be bromine, anything, okay? So if you replace one of the hydrogens, and then in the other compound you replace the other hydrogen and you compare the compounds. So are they enantiomers? No, they are not enantiomers. Are they diastereomers? No, they are not diastereomers. They are the same molecules. Hence these protons are homotopic. Okay? And homotopic protons in NMR give only one signal. Okay? Now let's talk about enantiotopic protons. Okay? And there is a very simple way to explain enantiotopic protons, and I'll take the example of ethanol. Okay? So let's take the example of ethanol. So we have CH3, C, OH, okay? Then we have one hydrogen, let's say above the plane, okay? And we have one hydrogen below the plane. Okay, now again we'll do the same thing. We'll replace this group by say X, okay? Or we can take it to be chlorine. So let's replace this hydrogen by chlorine. So what we get is, so above the plane we have chlorine. Then we have hydrogen. And then we have this OH. Okay, and in the other compound we replace this particular hydrogen by chlorine, okay? So what you're going to get is CH3, C, hydrogen bonding chain, bromine, OH. Okay, now let's compare these two molecules. Now if you see, if you take out the configuration, we will give this the highest priority 1, this is the second priority 2, and carbon is the third priority. And hydrogen is the lowest molecular weight compound, so we will just let it be on the fourth position. And the fourth position compound should be below the pane. So now if we calculate the configuration, so 1, 2, 3, so that is, it is going clockwise, so it's a R configuration. So this has R configuration. Now coming on to this, again 1, 2, 3. So we have R configuration, but this hydrogen is above the plane. So the lowest priority molecule or the atom is above the plane. So then we take the opposite configuration. So this is S configuration. So what you can see is, by replacing both the hydrogens one at a time, one by first replacing this by chlorine and then replacing the other one by chlorine, what we got is 2 enantiomers. Okay. So hence you can say that these two particular hydrogens over here, in this case in ethanol, are enantiotopic. Okay, so these protons are enantiotopic. Now the thing to remember is, even enantiotopic protons do not give different signals in NMR. They do give the same NMR signals. Okay, but in the presence of a chiral solvating agent, or in presence of say like in a human body, our proteins are also very specific, right? So they have a particular, they themselves are chiral. So once these protons come in a chiral field, like when you use chiral solvating agents, I think you might have read about it in NMR. If you haven't, just Google it, chiral solvating agents. Okay, so they themselves are chiral, and when these hydrogens come in a chiral environment and they interact with a chiral molecule, then they give different chemical shift values. Okay, so in the presence of a chiral solvating agent, they can give different peaks in NMR, but otherwise they give the same peak in absence of chiral solvating agents. Okay, and this particular center over here, or this carbon center, is called a prochiral carbon. So this particular carbon is termed as prochiral. That is, it has the ability to become a chiral. So any carbon is called prochiral if only by one substitution, just one substitution, we can make the carbon chiral. So what we did here was, we replaced one of the hydrogens by chlorine, that is, we carried out one substitution, and by carrying out one substitution, we got a chiral compound. Okay, so why is this enantiotopic protons important? Because when you're doing reactions, like when you're doing a reaction where you're replacing the CH bond by a CCl bond, okay? So in that case, you should also be aware of the stereochemistry, because you know that in the beginning, the reactant has no chiral centers. But once the product is formed, then it can have a chiral center, and then you need to focus on the stereochemistry of the product, okay? So that's important. Okay, now coming on to the diastereotopic protons. Diastereotopic protons. So let's say we have this particular compound. Okay. Now again we do one thing. If we need to find out whether these two hydrogens over here are enantiotopic, homotopic, or diastereotopic, we'll replace one of these hydrogens one by one. So we'll say we replace it by a group called X. Okay. So what we get is C double bond C X H H Cl. Okay, so this is the cis isomer. Now we'll draw the other one. We'll replace this hydrogen in this case. Now we'll replace this hydrogen. So what we get is bromine, a hydrogen. In this case, we get a trans product. Okay, so in this case, we are getting trans, in this case, we are getting cis. So, what are cis and trans isomers? They are nothing but diastereomers. So, hence, you can say that these two particular protons over here are diastereotopic protons. And the fact is that diastereotopic protons give different NMR signals. Okay, so they have different chemical shift values and they can be differentiated by NMR in general. Okay, so this was about diastereotopic protons. Now let's just look at an example and see like if a question comes for the number of NMR signals. So how can we use this concept to give the number of NMR signals in a given molecule? Okay. So let's say we have this molecule over here, okay, and so we have a cyclopropane ring and we have a chlorine attached, and this is the structure, okay, and this can be called the cis form, okay, of cyclopropane, and the other one is, you can take the trans one. Okay, this is the trans. Now let's see how many different signals will be obtained for the cis isomer and the trans isomer. So if you look at these hydrogens, now if a layman sees this particular molecule, he will say these two protons give one signal, this proton gives one signal, so there will be two signals. Similarly, over here you will say two signals will be there. Okay, but you have to see the environment and you have to see whether these protons are diastereotopic or not. Okay, so let's just replace one of the hydrogens over here by say X group. Okay, so let's say we replace it by X group. So now if you see this X over here, okay, it's in trans with this chlorine and it's in trans with this chlorine and it is in cis with these hydrogens. Okay, now if you replace this particular hydrogen by X, now the things change. Now this X is in cis with these chlorines and it is in trans with these hydrogens. So you can see that they both are in a different environment, that is, they are giving a diastereomer. So these two hydrogens are diastereotopic. Okay, so since they are diastereotopic, so these two hydrogens will give different signals in the NMR spectrum. So two signals for one signal for this hydrogen, one signal for this hydrogen, so there will be two signals. Okay, and similarly if you replace this hydrogen, I will not show you, if you can do it on your own, if you replace this hydrogen by X and if you replace this hydrogen by X, or I will show you. Okay, if you replace this hydrogen by X, you see it is in trans with this chlorine, okay, and it is in cis with this hydrogen and it is in trans with this hydrogen. Okay, and if you similarly replace this by X, then again what we have is trans with this chlorine, cis with this hydrogen, cis with this hydrogen, and cis with trans with this hydrogen. So they both are having the same chemical environment and there is no change in the molecule. Okay, so hence we can say that these two protons are either homotopic or enantiotopic. Okay, but you have to see whether the change from H to X is causing a in this case they will be enantiotopic. Okay, so enantiotopic protons do not give different peaks in NMR, so you can say these two will have the same peaks. So one peak for these hydrogens and one peak for this hydrogen and one peak for this hydrogen. So we'll have three peaks in the NMR spectrum. So we'll have three peaks. Okay, similarly if you go on to this molecule, now here I'll use a different concept. Okay, so you can use whichever works for you. So here I thought about replacing it with X. Now here I'll be talking about just looking at the environment. Okay, so if you look at this hydrogen isn't cis with this chlorine, it is in trans with this chlorine. Okay, so it is in cis with one chlorine and it is in trans with one chlorine. Similarly, it is in cis with one hydrogen and it is in trans with one hydrogen. Okay,
Now coming on to this hydrogen. Now this hydrogen as well is in cis with one chlorine and trans with one chlorine. It is in cis with one hydrogen and it is in trans configuration with one hydrogen. That means these two hydrogens are actually similar. Okay, similar as in they are not diastereotopic, they can be enantiotopic or homotopic. So if we again replace, now I'll show you the second method. Now if you replace this by X, so it's one and the same thing. So this X is in trans with this chlorine, it is in cis with this chlorine. Okay, and if you replace over here by X, again it is in cis with one chlorine and it is in trans with one chlorine. So you can see that the chemical environment for both the hydrogens is same. So you can say these two hydrogens will give only one peak. And coming on to this, again the same thing. This hydrogen is in cis with this hydrogen and trans with this hydrogen, and it is in cis with one chlorine. Similarly, this hydrogen, it is in cis with one chlorine, it is in trans, it is in cis with one hydrogen, and it is in trans with one hydrogen. So then we can say that these two hydrogens are also equivalent. Okay, that is, they could be enantiotopic or homotopic, and so they will give only one signal. So the total number of signals for the trans isomer will be 2. So this is the way we can solve these such questions, because such questions are really tricky and they can come in the exam, or they have actually come in one of the NET exams, and they are more than likely to come in JAM as well. So this is the concept you need to apply. Okay, and so here I am talking about the number of peaks. They can actually also ask you whether they can give you two hydrogens. They can give you this hydrogen, and then ask what is the relationship, whether they are homotopic, diastereotopic or enantiotopic, right? So you can say that these two hydrogens in this case are diastereotopic. Okay.